Hello everyone, taking a bit of a break from 24 Hours of Doom to talk with Doom Eternal game director Hugo Martin. Hugo, are you there?
I am here. Thank you for having me so much.
Oh, you made the game. Don't thank me. I'm just sitting here playing it. Thank you for making an awesome game and taking time out of your weekend just to chat with people in the community. Thank you very much.
Oh, you know, it's easy work for us. I mean, honestly, we love doing it for you guys, and it's our way of trying to give thanks back to the community. Lawrence, I've seen you play the game, and I watched you play through Tag 2, and I think I'm just so appreciative of the content you've I love your content. It's awesome, and we've never had a chance to speak before, so it's just I'm pretty excited to do this.
Well, thank you very much. That means a lot to me. It's one thing to play and enjoy a game, but to have the person who actually put it together, I don't know, it's full circle. It's kind of blowing my mind right now. So thank you.
Well, you got emotional at the little note that we left for the fans, and I too get a little emotional when I think about that, and like, because it is our opportunity. We really do care. Obviously, everyone does. I don't know that makes us special, but we really, really did make this game for you guys. And we just love watching people play it. I loved that moment on your stream. Like, it was so genuine. And I was like, man, this guy gets it. This is fantastic.
Oh, thank you very much. Man, it's interesting you bring that up, the weird kind of two-way communication that happens there. Because to me, I grew up in a small Texas town and
you're from Texas?
Yeah. I grew up in Azle, which is kind of the DFW area. No, dude, it gets weird. I actually, out of college, got a job in the building that id Software is in right now. I worked for Argo Data. I don't know if they're still there.
Oh, my God.
Yeah,
that's,
and then
amazing.
Id Software moved in there, like, right before I quit, which was probably a good thing, because if they had moved in earlier, I probably would have just creeped around the lobby, kind of like, oops, accidentally dropping a resume here and there. But, yeah. There was my like cultural touchstones were things like QuakeCon, and then the weird bit of humanity I could get through just the tiniest straw through playing video games. So to me, to have those moments of expression from the creators to the players means a lot. And it's really cool now to think that can go back the other way, that now the creators can actually watch people play and enjoy what they've created. So
it's awesome. It really is. Like, you see when someone connects with the content, and you so did. Like, that was the coolest part. Like, you got what we were trying to do. The combat puzzle make you think, like, oh, why is this? Why am I cursed? What does this mean? Well, we're just trying to, engage you, like, make you, like, it really is. I said this during the promotion of the game. We wanted to give people something that was worth their time to master, a combat puzzle that was worth their time to solve. So I think some of, hey, why can't I just shoot everything with a shotgun? It's like, well, I mean, we wanted to try to give you something a little bit different. And watching you play and watching you engage with that puzzle and really get it, like, and embrace it, was, like so many people was just awesome. And you're, what I like too is, like, you're good at the game. You're really good at the game, but you're not otherworldly. Like, and that, I mean that in the highest compliment, like, you're amazing. You're way better than me, but like, and I love our black belts in our community, but like, when I watch you play, like, you're just really good at the game, but you're not doing anything necessarily that's like otherworldly, and that's awesome to see. Not that I don't like when people do amazing stuff, of course, but it's just cool. Like, you're just a real genuine fan of the game. That's awesome. We wanted the game to have a really high skill ceiling, because we felt like that's what 2016 lacked. Like, it's an awesome game. It stands on its own. We're not saying it's better. It was just like, well, what can we do to make this game stand on its own? And it's like, let's provide them with an experience that has real depth. I think the more you give Doom Eternal, the more you get out of it. The first playthrough, I think you kind of skim the surface of some of the depth there. But I think we really tried to make it so the game kind of encouraged you to play at higher difficulties. I'm proud to say that, like, I think in 2016, the higher difficulty you played in, it kind of pushed you into the exploits. Like, when it really mattered, you were like, I'm just going to double shotgun super shotgun everything, which is special in its own way. But I think with Eternal, the higher the difficulty you play, the more it pushes you into all of its systems, where it's like, hey, the ice bomb that you could ignore on Hurt Me Plenty, you kind of got to use it on Nightmare or playing through Blood Swamps, you know? And I watched your first playthrough and your first review. I'm not like a stalker, but I have watched a lot of your content. And I watched your first playthrough, and it was awesome because then you progressively like became a black belt, you know, of Doom Eternal. Like you, and now you're like amazing. But it's cool, and you're using the tools, and it is going back to your original point. I'm kind of on a rant here. Is that you? We get the same kind of experience that you guys get, absolutely, through Twitch. I mean, through Twitch and YouTube. It's a fantastic time to be a creator. You get to see people like, you know, engage with your experience real time, and when they connect with it like you did, it means a lot to us.
Damn. Well, man, I was prepared to be the one who was just gushing, but thank you very much. I appreciate that. I mean, you hit on a number of topics that I'm really fascinated to ask about. I think the first one.
Yeah.
So you mentioned, and you have in several other interviews about, you came to 2016 and you know, you made the chessboard, but then in Eternal you refined it and actually kind of added mechanical complexity, which to me is very rare when it comes to any single player experience that's sort of iterative. And maybe this is a hypothesis that needs disputing, but it seems to me that when a game company releases a single player game and it comes out and it sells well enough, the trend seems to always be with the sequel to make it more approachable, to sort of offer up the same fantasy but with less friction. That's just been a pattern that I've sort of anecdotally observed. But with Eternal, you kind of did the opposite. You took a game and actually dove into the mechanics and made it a more functionally complicated game, raised the skill cap, like you said. But that seems to fly in the face of typically what I would presume is a sort of process that makes games try to sell more as they go on and on. So
and we did sell more doing it. That's what's the cool part is, like, you know, you could say I don't want to call it a gamble, but the approach paid off because in the stats that count, you know, we've gone up pretty much across the board. I mean, like, slightly higher completion rates, did better in every category, really. You know, they want that complexity, whether it's in a League of Legends or an Overwatch or a Fortnite, these games with these high skill ceilings, these loops that they're asking you to master. And so the evidence is everywhere that, like, you know, providing the player with something to master, you know, usually if you do it well enough, leads to increased engagement levels with your game. Being willing to hold the player accountable, to have stakes in your game, you know, like, that I think just feels, is a genre of gaming that I don't think every game needs to be like that, you know, but ours, you know, happens to prescribe to that, those kind of stakes and holding the player accountable in that way. And you're right. Like when you look back on, I mean, I could gush about Resident Evil in the same way, right? I mean, I had this conversation with Mayo that, like, I mean, God, they make a bullet count, right? It's they get it down to like a single bullet, and when you miss a shot, you're like, oh my God, like that's gonna suck. And I think that's where the engagement on that game is so high, you know, when I play it. And I love other games that don't work that way too. I mean, it's not what I want in everything. Again, I wouldn't want one genre of music to take over everything, but or one genre of gaming, obviously. But it is where we focused on. It's good questions, Lawrence. I mean, you definitely see what we're putting down there, and all the questions you're asking is kind of like 4 years ago. That was the discussion. It was like fist on the table, like respect the players, honestly, their skill, their willingness to go on a journey with you. Really, really try to clean it up so they're not dying to bugs and problems. You know, like when they die, they know what they did wrong and they're anxious to go back. Have we had a patch or two where Blood Punch doesn't work and sometimes the game is killing you? We've done that, so my apologies. but yeah, it's like respect the gamer's time and that for people who like that stuff, you know, provide them with that. Don't I almost feel like it's like take the swimmies off, like leave me alone, like let me do it, you know, like, and let me earn this. And which just feels good.
You talked about basically giving people, like asking people to make the hike, but then giving them some help along the way. I've had an interesting encounter with some people about Doom Eternal specifically, because, you know, you do ask people to do more in Doom Eternal, and I think that pays off in the end, obviously, but there are people who came to Doom Eternal and then said, you know, I just want this to be, I run up and I shotgun demons, it should be a power fantasy, and just give it to me, like, don't make me work for it. The thing is, like, Eternal does allow that through the use of cheats or difficulty, but I've also seen the same people who say that that's what they want it to be, just an easy power fantasy, also don't want to turn on the options that would make it that way. There's like an interesting bravado there. I think specifically also about Doom, a game that sort of teases and tempts you to try to do harder things, that I find that some players, maybe even longtime players that have a lot of pride in their abilities, but, you know, don't want to be stressed when they're playing a game, find it hard for themselves to, you know, play the game the way that they say they want to play it. Have you noticed that too? Is there like a weird cognitive gap there that
yeah.
Yeah.
If I had to do it over again, I think that Doom should have like a slaughter mode, you know, like I think that's where a modern game convention of like a casual mode, you know, we're not going to put that in the game or anything, but like I don't feel like we need to compromise our experience. I don't think that would compromise our experience, you know, like, so I think like some version of that, I think, kind of answers that, because again, I want Doom to be for everyone, you know, but,
Well, you called it a slaughter mode, which I think right away, like that branding is so much better than like easy mode or no kill, like no die mode, invincible mode. Like those sound, to me, it just seems to be like a perceptive problem where if you call it slaughter mode, then suddenly it sounds way more badass than we're putting the training wheels back on mode, you know?
Absolutely. I mean, it's look, it is putting a staircase up to the top of Mount Everest, you know, like that's okay. You know, like some of those people wanted to have that kind of experience. And I think slaughter mode is more empowering. I totally agree. Like, rather than like newbie mode, you know, like, or whatever, like we don't need to be, I'm not into that. I, you know, we slam our fists on the table and say, let's give them a puzzle, you know, that's worth their time to solve something, give them something to master. Right. But that also doesn't mean that, like, you know, you have to be elitist about it and say, well, what if somebody doesn't? Well, cool. Like, let's, you know, maybe next time there's a slaughter mode, and it's a balanced power fantasy that, you know, still holds you accountable, but like loosens up a bit in areas. I think that's perfectly fine.
How much information would you say you need to have in your brain at any one time? Or do you essentially have the entire scope of the game at any point in your head? Or do you like, what organizational tools have you developed to help you execute your job and track the amount of information you probably have to track?
It's funny because that tool has been taken away from me in COVID, and right now, you know, we're working on some stuff, and I'm having a little bit of a hard time. I'm adjusting, but I live next to a whiteboard. I mean, my office, I have an office, but I'm never in it. I basically just hang out in this one office space that we have at id that has you know, whiteboards all around. And basically that room becomes like the hub for the game, because I'll end up drawing. I basically communicate everything visually with, like, you know, just abstract little pictures. And I mean, I know how to draw, so like I use that skill. And I'll just basically communicate to the team, like, themes, ideas, high level concepts, and then track them by basically just not erasing the whiteboard.
I presume that by offering up your time, you are hoping to sort of, you know, pour a little lighter fluid on the community and keep the game going and active.
Yeah, because I think that we saw with the mods and people playing the game that this community kind of sprang up, you know, and obviously with the DLCs, I mean, it didn't just spring up out of nowhere. I mean, we provided them with new content, you know, and master levels. So yeah, I mean, it's an opportunity to speak to the artists that are using the instrument, you know, like the people who are doing some of the most impressive stuff with it, you know?
I told
Sean that I was like, I got to talk to Lawrence. Like, this is, well, he brought it up too, like that you were a big fan, and I know you guys know each other, but I was like, yeah, man, I've seen his streams. I mean, that guy's amazing.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that. I mean, it's like I said before, it's enough for me to just I mean, I'm grateful that you made the thing, and I consider myself lucky to be in the world at the same time as it. So, but beyond that, man, I really appreciate it. On that note, I think you guys deserve a lot of congratulations for not only making a game like Doom Eternal, but then successfully releasing two DLCs that are both very well crafted. That on its own, regardless of anything else, is pretty rare, I would think. A single player, content rich, mechanically dense game that then has two like canon story based follow ups. Like the FromSoft games don't really do that. Really, not a whole lot of games do. The ones that do, the DLC is not really given the time or the maturation that Tag 1 and 2 clearly have. So, first of all, congratulations. Second of all, to what would you attribute Doom Eternal's success in that? Yeah, Witcher 3 is another one, I guess. GTA had some good expansions.
The team. You know, it's not like we work together really well. Again, all of this design stuff doesn't mean anything without you know, a good group of people working together well, and so with the DLCs, we honestly got to flex a little bit. That's what it kind of felt like. Even in COVID, you could feel it in the office. I mean, we were all working from home at that point, but it was just kind of like I would joke all the time. I'm like, we're the world's leading expert on making Doom content, you know. So let's make more Doom content.
So I've got one more question for you. I mean, I could keep going, but I won't, because I want to get back to playing Doom. all right, this is the last one, so it's got to be a big one, right? This is the gotcha. It was all fun and games until now. Now's the big stuff. I want to get you trapped. This is from a member of the community. Scott asks, and again, this is the big one. There's no weaseling out of this. You're gonna want to weasel out of it, but I'm not gonna let you. All right.
Okay.
Is Doom Guy hot?
Is he hot?
Yeah.
I mean, his eyes are kind of far apart. So that's, you're saying hot as in attractive.
Yes.
So, I mean, I'm not gonna lie. His eyes are kind of awkwardly a little far apart. So that's a little weird. I think that makes him like really unsettling. You know what I mean? Like he's kind of got this like his, you don't know if he's like intelligent or what's going on there. And like, I don't think he's unintelligent. I mean, I don't think he's like, you know, a mouth breathing Jason Voorhees type, but like, I mean, we do model him and his personality after like Michael Myers, and you know, he's somewhere, he's like one part Rambo, one part Michael Myers, one part Terminator. And, is he hot? I don't.
It's, I love the question. Well, like, yeah. It's such an obvious question, but also sexuality doesn't exist in the Doom games. Like, it's just not part of that universe. So to think about it crossing over.
I'll be honest. He's the hero of our game, so I'm reluctant to say he's not. That seems wrong. The hero's got to be, I suppose, you know, according to the tropes, he's supposed to be attractive, he or she. But I got to go with the eyes are a little far apart. It's a little weird looking.
Weird looking. Kind of like a bird of prey. Like he has like 360 degree vision because his eyes are sort of wall-eyed out.
That's true. I would say, sure. Did you watch Godzilla vs. King Kong?
I did, yeah.
What did you think?
I really liked it.
I loved it.
I was like an hour into it, and I was like, why hasn't every kaiju film in the last 20 years been exactly like this?
Oh my God, yes. Just no more cutting away when they fight.
Yeah.
God, that drove me so nuts.
They always want to treat it like a tease. Like, somehow, I haven't already bought my ticket, and I'm in for the ride. I don't get it.
Yeah. Oh God, that would drive me crazy. Where it's just like, they're going to fight. And then it was like, oh my God, what are you doing? Like, I don't care what this person is doing right now. Get back to Godzilla. and then you'd get back to him and he's like already beating up the guy or something. It's just like, oh my God.
Yeah, you just see his tail disappearing into the ocean. Come on!
Thank you so much for this opportunity. It's been awesome. And my apologies that the audio is not better. I hope it wasn't too bad.
Oh, it's totally fine. This is your day off, or hopefully your day off. So thank you for spending part of it chatting with me. I mean, first of all, thank you for making the game. That's hard work is what all of this flows from, you and your team. So I very much appreciate that. But the fact that you would, you know, break off time on your time off to do that, you got a family and all that stuff, so means a lot. I very much appreciate it. Thank you for talking with me for over almost 2.5 hours. I very much appreciate it, and thank you for all your work. Now, go enjoy your Saturday with your family.
Thank you so much. This was awesome, and thank you for all the fans. Lawrence, thank you for your support. You are definitely a master of the game. Who are you? You're Jimmy Page. You're Eddie Van Halen. Pick one. You're one of them. Jeez. You're one of the greats.
You're being too kind. Thank you, though. I appreciate it.
I'll be watching your next stream, and we stream every Thursday, sort of every Thursday. So I think we're on to The Holt next, which everyone is anxiously awaiting me beating the Samur fight on Nightmare with a bass controller, which should be really interesting. Might be a 4-hour stream. See how it goes.
You'll teach everybody how to do it, right? They can't complain once you do it.
Exactly. All right, man. I'll talk to you later, buddy.
All right. See you around.